safe is Wigan's hold on the championship. King Ellery is gone. Can they wear the crown again without him? It's up to new men like the Kiwi Sam Panapa. Today's opponents, Hull, know the danger of giving him half a yard. Unsung stalwarts like Billy McGinty from Warrington are the force now in Wigan's pack. A big new stand tightened the purse string. David Myers is this season's brightest star at Central Park. He's turned from a winger of promise into a try machine. 16 so far, the league's third top scorer. And that's just what his coach John Mooney needs. He says December is crunch time for Wigan. Three vital home games, Hull today, then Castleford, and fulfilling a great tradition, St Helens on Boxing Day.
Well, we've got to stay in touch with the leaders. We've got 12 points, and if we win our remaining two games, we'd only be 1 point behind the leaders. So it's very important that in December we win our games.
Like Wigan, Hull have a trophy-winning season to live up to. The man who lifted the Premiership silverware, Greg Mackey, is now an even more important figure, with four men from that campaign departed. The little Australian halfback is leading a young team. They're not exactly babes in arms, Lee Jackson, maybe only 22, but he's an established test hooker. And Richard Gay, also 22, another real candidate for Great Britain's tour of Australia next summer. The bad news is Andy Jannett's eight-match ban, Hull deprived of his power by the disciplinary verdict on Ellery Hanley's broken jaw. And despite the newfound form of the former Welsh Rugby Union international Mark Jones, Hull know they'll have their work cut out at Central Park.
Well, it's always a daunting task, John, simply because it's Wigan. While we've won five out of our last six or something like that, we haven't been exceptionally well, you know, in our game, and maybe the build up we've had is would have preferred to have been playing a little bit better at least.
Field today introduces his new signing from Sydney St George, Peter Spring, in the front row in place of Dannett. On the bench, David Ronson and Ian Marlow are back after a head, leg and an ankle tendon injury. And watch for Paul Eastwood. With six tries and 65 goals, only Jonathan Davies in the whole league has more points. Wigan welcome back Steve Hampson after four games out with hamstring trouble, and Kelvin Skerritt has been missing for the same period with a knee injury. With Andy Gregory suspended, Sam Panapa switches from centre to stand-off, and Sean Edwards, after passing a fitness test on a knee, gets another chance to take a claim for the scrum half role on the tour to Australia. There are Australians touring here now. They're stars of the future. The under-19 international against Great Britain at Headingley is later in scrum down. And how will Peter Spring fare in his first game since arriving from an Aussie summer? Let's find out with David Watkins and John Helm.
Thank you, Nick, and welcome to England to Peter Spring. And David, I don't think you could have chosen a colder day. It's freezing at Wigan.
Certainly can't, but you'll soon find that the atmosphere and the play here will be hot enough for him this afternoon.
He looks a big lad, doesn't he?
He really does look a big fellow, and him and Mark Jones as well look pretty formidable as a front row.
Yes, it's a big whole pack chosen by Noel Crusher-Cleal. Referee Galtres from Bradford is awarding the first penalty of the game. And guess who it's against? It's against Peter Spring. He's made an immediate impact.
Well, just watch this. It's virtually the first tackle of the game. And he comes in here, he takes him a bit high. Cowie doesn't appreciate it, and neither does the referee, and is awarded a penalty to Wigan.
Edwards kicking. Safe catch by Paul Eastwood. He showed it and then came straight up the middle into Cherry and White. Jones coming into things for the first time. Hull certainly look to be fired up for this. As you would expect, any team coming to Central Park has to get their preparation right. Hull arrived a good hour and a half before kickoff. And although their results have been impressive recently, their performances haven't been great. Nonetheless, they've been winning matches. Steve Hampson making an uncomfortable job of that one.
Come on there, that's it! Get up! Come on!
David Myers, one of the top try scorers in rugby league this season. Myers, who got a hat-trick against Papua New Guinea, playing for the Great Britain under 21 side. Along the line it goes. Kanapa is playing at standoff half. There's been some speculation as to whether he might actually play on the wing and that Botica might play at number six. Nice tackle. Pitch in excellent condition thanks to the blanket here which was switched on. It's a very soft surface. Eastwood for the second time. Slipping the ball out nicely. Success under Brian Smith's management. Hull have actually only won here twice since the war. It's not been one of their favourite grounds to come to. Both fullbacks are being tested with these probing kicks up the middle. Hull have already got an injury, and it is Peter Spring.
Yes, he's been badly walking across. He looks as if he's taken one big bang in that tackle there, a result of which he's having great difficulty in keeping his feet.
There he is, what an introduction to British Rugby League for Peter Spring. Clark looking to get the ball away, when he did offload it, it was into no man's land really. Now he can't get much farther than a couple of yards into the Hull half. Dermot. Edwards, what's he going to do? There's no doubt about it, they will miss Andy Gregory, he's such a schemer.
Well, yes, they are, and it's all a little predictable at the moment, but no doubt at all they're weighing down the defence, and that's exactly what they are doing. But Hull have been equal to the task. They've covered remarkably well.
Edwards must hoist it. Oh, a little chip, an angle kick. Wigan giving chase. Myers is there as well. Ooh, we nearly got a touchdown. There was a boot came in to flip the ball out of play, and that's the closest, and it was a clever little kick from Edwards.
Well, that's right. This is what Edwards is always capable of doing, breaking the game up. He saw there was an opportunity behind then the defence. He put it back there, and of course the ball can bounce anywhere. It is slightly hard underfoot, but fortunately for Hull, the ball went dead.
Wigan looking for the first try. Clark onto Betts. 25 yards out, and the whistle has gone, and a penalty awarded for offside against Wigan's Chico Jackson.
Well, that's one of the problems you always have when you're playing against a Wigan side. When they start moving the ball wide, you start creeping up to get up there a little bit quicker. Too quick on that occasion, and of course the referee has caught them at it, and that's a penalty opportunity for Wigan.
Fran Obotica would be a favourite to kick this one, I would think.
Well, he's a remarkably consistent goal kicker. He takes his time, he has a peculiar swing with his foot, but he really does place nearly everything between those sticks.
He's just been out of the game with an injury too, his kicking boot, but he says that that is better. His kicking foot was the one that was injured, rather than the one he stands on and puts all his weight on. Something you would know about, David, obviously, as a goal kicker of repute.
Well, timing makes all the difference, and when you get a rhythm and you can keep that rhythm going as he did there, that's all that really comes and matters.
The first points of the afternoon belong to Wigan and Fran Obotica. Down on the Hull bench, contact is maintained with Noel Cleal. His position away from there. Along the line it goes, but no gaps appearing. Hull's defensive work recently has been of the highest order. Useful punt again by Edwards. As Nick was saying at the top of the programme, he's keen to impress Malcolm Reilly as the scrum half. There is a vacancy, of course, in the number 7 shirt since Andy Gregory has decided not to play for his country again.
Well, there's no doubt in the qualities of Edwards' play. I mean, one of the things he can do, he brings forwards onto him. He's a very good player himself by reads play well. And he can bring in his tactical kicking is of the highest order.
Might he pick that up in a good position there, but Myers coming across and covering, as all good wingers should, made the tackle. Wigan don't leave many gaps, that's for sure. Ross Ward. Walker. Length is to come in for Hull. Good acquisition he's been from Barrow. Mackie kicks. This time Hampson takes it behind him. That's all right. Plenty of room in which to make up his mind what to do, and spins it out wide for Botica. Oh, that's a tough tackle indeed. Brian Blacker and Lee Jackson.
That really gained a lot of ground then, because what Hampson did, he ran into the middle, drew the defence, and then threw on ball out, which means that Botica had 10, 15 yards to make room upfield.
Excellent fullback player. Now they combine well, and this looks dangerous. Gene Miles, our first sight of the Australian on scrum down. Great Australian test centre. Quarter of an hour gone. Wigan 2, Hull 0. Wigan throwing it around, and suddenly Cowie found himself in some space, and there Cowie goes, and there's great support here. Wigan have a great chance of scoring. They take it. Sean Edwards.
Well, it was important, Edwards' reaction in first place in getting rid of the pass to put Cowie in the clear. Cowie then makes ground forward with McGinty in support, but it's Edwards again, the man who's there, backing up as always to score under the post.
Botica's conversion makes it 8-0, and Hull have a lot to do.
Now it's sure that he makes the room going forward. McGinty in support. Look, there's three, four Wigan players there. It's Edwards again on sand. Scores under the sticks.
Edwards. Kelvin Skerritt. Durbin flinging out the pass. Dennis Betts can't get it away. He's smothered. Concentrating most of their attacks at that left-hand side, which might be surprising to some, as David Myers is their top try scorer on the right wing. Anyway, again, Edwards goes left with it. There's no progress for Betts to make. Edwards with that little chip through again, and that's inviting Myers to go for it. Bit mighty. Myers might get the touchdown, does he? No, referee Goldschmidt says it's a dropout under the post, and David Myers was very close indeed to his 17th of the season.
Well, they're perfectly judged kicks, and they've taken the ball, as you said, John, to the left-hand side all the time, and suddenly turns and kicks it to the right. The defence really were there in numbers, but they really weren't too good about it, and he was very unfortunate not to get the try there.
Edwards, Panapa, not seen much of him after the opening 10 minutes. Summer signings. They have to replace people of the quality of Ellery Hanley and Kevin Ira, of course, here. That's a good ball. And Edwards tries to open them up down the right. Kelvin Skerritt goes shoulder down, and that was an excellent tackle. It really was by Marlowe. Edwards, and a nasty one for Gay. Oh, and he knocks on, and the ball then comes off the post, and he knocks on again. And that was a horrible position in which to take a kick of that sort.
Well, it was a horrible position, but what a superb kick again by Edwards. He's now starting to be the little general again and starting to organise play. He's keeping it fairly simple, but they are gradually wearing down this Hull side. And one wonders when and if the cracks do appear, what will happen to them.
And Neil Cowie has had to go off. We're bringing in Lucas into the action. There is Ian Lucas, who came back into the side last week as a substitute against Widnes. Prop forward of immense promise. Wigan would like another score before the interval. There is Lucas. A nice little manoeuvre. Not quite worked out for Wigan as yet, because Hull spotted it. Edwards, longer one this time for Miles, who can't get into the gap though. Once more, a good tackle by Harrison. Less sure that the ball had been knocked forward in the tackle. It was a very good tackle by young Paul Harrison, who tended to be overshadowed by his elder brother Carl, but has proved himself a good player in his own right.
Yes, it was a super tackle, man and ball. Miles had no chance at all then, of course, and he dropped the ball, and it meant that they had the scrum with head and ball, which means that they can start playing with it.
30 minutes gone, and Chico Jackson, they're very close to getting Richard Gay moving. The referee is acknowledging his touch judge on the far side there for spotting something that I think he hadn't seen. Referee Galtris much in the eyes, of course, because he was the referee who didn't see the Andy Dannett tackle on Ellery Hanley. That's not a criticism of him. I mean, referees can't be expected to see everything.
I must admit, I was witness of the game, and the tackle took place, and I didn't really see what happened until I had the advantage myself, hindsight of seeing the replays after.
Easy for us sitting up here, the benefits of replay monitors. Now McGinty goes for Wigan. Andy Dannett is in the crowd here today. Can't wait to get back into the action. He's thirsting for it, I can tell you. Edwards does get the pass away, and there are chances here now. Fanapa, oh, excellent work, and what a soul! What a great score that is from Sam Fanapa.
Edwards in a spot of bother here, but didn't panic at all. He took the tacklers, one, two, but then got it out. Fanapa then pushed off Eastwood, moved his way infield, and won himself round the tackle. What a superb try that was.
He scored against both Hull sides last season. I remember a hat-trick for Sheffield Eagles against Hull Kingston Rovers. He also scored for them against the Early Birds, and now he's on target again for Wigan with his ninth try of the season. Makes it 3 out of 3 from his right boot, and Wigan extend their lead to 14-0.
Well, Edwards never panicked here at all, actually. He was caught by the first tackler and the second tackler, would have still been able to get the ball away. But Panapa's run from depth there, and seeing that he was in trouble, Edwards took the ball on the burst, shot round the defence that was half surprised by the whole thing, and scored a superb try under the post.
Indeed.
Very much a Christmas pantomime about that. That was superb. You ought to pay for that.
I think you used to do that sort of thing, though.
Only when I was not, John.
Only when you'd have a Christmas drink, possibly. Oh, brilliant ball. What a great pass that was. Superbly done, and Edwards keeps it going. The referee said it was a forward pass from Betts to Edwards. But that really showed dexterity of the highest order.
But isn't that the confidence in the side and the ability of this Wigan side to turn half chances into real chances?
We don't write them off. Terry Smirke will take it from the scrum for Hull. They need something before half time if they're to stand a chance in this match.
Yes, they've been somewhat disappointed. They haven't really put anything together themselves in attack, really, now for some time, and they've been subjected to an awful lot of pressure from the Wigan side, who have played it fairly simple but have run straight and hard all the time.
Bulldozing run from Jones. Now Mackie, he's the one they look to for some inspiration. Clever little halfback. A problem, he's there to scoop it up again, and now he whips it inside, and Wigan do fall on it this time. Well, Grant Mackey, I think, was trying to be inventive. There is a danger of an interception, of course, but he's got to try something.
Well, I think it's important now, because they don't look to have got anywhere with this defence at all at Wigan's, and for somebody like Mackey to start doing things like that can only do good for them, because they've got to try and prize it open. The orthodox isn't doing just that.
Walker then caught his opponent to the dislike of referee Galtris. 5 minutes from half time, Wigan 14, Hull 0. It's not the scoreline that Noel Cleal was looking for.
Well,
reaffirmation if we needed it that you don't write Wigan off?
Well, I think it's rather silly to even suggest that you should write them off, because there are so many great players here, and when they play under a style which is very open, which has got people backing up all the time, and there's always commitment from a Wigan side, and therefore it's really awful to try and even write them.
They're stretching Hull again, and they're stretching them so well that McGinty's going to create a score. Oh, Bottinger. It should have been a score, and Frano Bottinger really must look to himself there, because McGinty put him in the plate.
Well, this is superb rugby by Wigan. They've moved it out to the left-hand side here, and Phil Clark goes away. He is able to get rid of it, so is Dean Bell on the inside ball. Now, McGinty does all the hard work, draws the fullback perfectly, and what does he do? Bottinger puts the ball to ground.
That's the last action of the first half, in which Hull have been very decidedly been second best. And Wigan will be very pleased indeed with their efforts of the first 40 minutes. Two tries coming from Sean Edwards and Sam Panapa, and three goals from Frano Bottinger, but nothing at all on the board as yet for Hull. It's 14-0 to Wigan. Park and Hull certainly have it all to do in the second half here. That's the scoreline, Wigan 14, Hull nil. So what are Hull going to do? Let's ask one of their players, John Sharp. He's with Nick.
John, it's a long, long way back from here. How do you change things to try and come back from 14-0 down?
That's a very nice question to ask. Obviously, we're going to be struggling at 14 down, but the lads have got tremendous character, and I don't think the scoreline suggests how the game's been going. We've had plenty of ball and that, but I think we've just let him off with his defence. I think at times it hasn't been intense enough, and we've let him off.
It seems to me that Peter Spring took a knock early on and is still suffering quite badly.
That's right. I think probably the first tackle of the game involving Kelvin Skerritt. He's taken a knock, and I think he's still struggling. I know he seems to be a little bit groggy on his feet.
You don't think you're going to win, do you?
I don't know. You never say die.
Thanks very much indeed, John. Let's see what happens with John.
So thanks very much to John Sharp and to Nick down there, freezing down on the touchline. A good crowd here at Central Park, and they will certainly expect Wigan to pick up the 2 points, I would think. Now let's have a look at the statistics of that first half. The scrum's going Wigan's way, but only just 4-3. Neither hooker took one against the head. There were 9 penalties in all, Hull conceding twice as many as Wigan. And the handling errors on a cold day, bear in mind Wigan made 8 to Hull's 5. The most critical of them, the one where Bottinger put the ball down with the line beckoning.
Yes, that certainly could have closed the whole thing up as far as Hull are concerned. As John Sharp says, you know, I think what's going to come out this half is the character and the commitment from the players. They know it's an uphill struggle against the Wigan side. It's very buoyant in front of their home supporters. But nonetheless, it is a game of never say die.
And there are 39 minutes left in which to change the course of events. They generally are looking to Mark Jones to drive them upfield. That's what he was doing again there. Now then, Mackey and Russell Walker. I think it's at half back, David, that they've got to get their game sorted out.
Yeah, no one's really taken on the defence and to making the gaps for the people, a result of which it's all becoming. I mean, that again is a bad pass, panic situation, trying to put the ball in front but nobody behind him again. This is something they'll have to get rid of if they're going to make any headway against this Wigan side that now are sitting on a 14-point lead.
I think if Wigan were really on song, David, they might have taken Hull apart today.
Well, yes, but they are clinically just wearing them down. And when they take the ball in with their big men, Skerritt and Phil Clark has taken it in, they're really tiring out this Hull side. And really, I think that's one of the reasons they can't put anything in together on attack.
An awful knock on by Sam Panapa, who took his eye off the ball at the precise moment when he shouldn't have done.
Well, that's for everybody to study on that. He was looking up to see who was coming down towards him when the ball was bouncing around on the floor.
Well, that act as an encouragement to Hull. Panapa got it all wrong, and Terry Smirk takes it and gives it for Greg Mackey. Now then, can he open them up here? He's prized them open slightly, and Brian Blacker caught by the ankle by Bottinger, but Hull, this is their chance to get back into it. Oh, good running. It's going to be a score. And what an excellent score by Greg Mackey.
Well, so much, and if there's one guy can do it in this Hull side, it's Mackey. And when he has the ball here, he demands to give it out to the right, catches the Wigan defence, snakes through the gap and straightens up for the line. No one can touch him.
He is a wily little player, Greg Mackey. We've not seen him at his best today. The man who won the Harry Sunderland Trophy in the Premiership final last year has brought Holt back into this with his fourth try of the season. John Boney certainly would not have been happy about that. And Noel Cleal will be happy about that. Eastwood's goal reduces the deficit to 14-6.
Well, he's tried all afternoon, Mackey has, to create some gap in this defence. He does it himself this time. He doesn't have to pass to anybody else. He sells the dummy, snakes through the gap and straightens up for the line.
Meanwhile, Mackey has been joined out there by the other substitute, David Ronson, who has replaced Peter Spring. There is one Australian replacing another, David Ronson.
That's a wise substitution. He got knocked early on this spring in the first half. He's never recovered. He really hasn't been part of the game. And although he probably left him on to see whether or not he could come back, he hasn't done so. And the substitution is taking place now early in the second half.
Ronson actually was the youngest player ever to sign for Manly when he was just 16 years of age. Well, let's see what he can do out here. He's a bit more experienced than that now. And referee Galtras again was not happy about the feel of the ball there by Hull and awards Wigan the penalty.
Well, that has staggered the Hull players, and Mackey looking in total disbelief at that, but Galdras has clearly said what has happened. The ball wasn't played in his finger, the man hadn't got up off the floor properly to play the ball, a result of which it's given Wigan an opportunity to kick a goal and really put them back well in front.
It's dead straight for Franno Botica. Doesn't take long. He's usually meticulous. Even so, and that is goal number 50 for him this season. So Wigan move further in front at 16-6. The player who has gone off, there he is, Peter Spring. What he'll remember about his first appearance in British Rugby League. Wigan have it. Scored the two tries to Hull's one. The one there, Miles did actually make a bit of ground. And now there's a chance for Wigan, and this is enterprising. Oh, lovely play, and Sean Edwards, a clever kick ahead as well. Myers goes for it, if he can keep it in, he might score. It's just gone out of play. Lovely handling, good break up the middle. Edwards and Myers in unison. Hull stuck with their desk.
Well, McGinty does well here. They bring this ball up the field here. McGinty now, he actually makes the break here, but brings again. Watch now, Edwards comes in here. But see, he sees his way blocked and he thinks, well, I've got Myers on my outside. Let's give him the opportunity. He's one of the quickest men on the field. But unfortunately, it just rolls into touch.
So taken out of the scrum by Blacker. Now, this is a good spell of sustained pressure by Hull. They have four more tackles from here. Lee Jackson, Terry Smirk along the line. That wasn't good. It's hit the boot of Ronson again. The knee, according to referee Galtris. So they're allowed to continue the movement. And Mark Jones gets inside the Wigan 25. And now a penalty is given, and that was because he didn't play the ball. Former Neath rugby union man, he's had a good game today, and the referee has held up a white card to show that this blood bin will be occupied shortly by Dean Bell. Often you get these situations where players don't want to go off, but nowadays the ruling is that if there is blood, they have to go. So it brings Neil Cowie back on.
As you said, John, it is only right. It looks a bad cut. There is an opportunity now for him to utilise the blood bank.
Game goes on. Harris actually nailed him in the end. You just get the feeling that Wigan are coming again.
Yes, they're starting to run with strength again now, and their organisation is good. They're bringing the heavy people onto it. They've got Miles on the outside.
Yes, he has, and he's got it inside for Kanapa as well, who's looking for the support. And this is dangerous for Hull. Wigan are looking for a clincher here now. If they can score another try, they might well be beyond the reach of Hull. Dennis Betts goes. The ball is put down. Eastwood picks it up for Hull. He was almost galloping away. Wigan have really put down too many passes for their own good in this one. Goes Ian Marlowe. Noel Cleal obviously thinking that he needs spring out there to sort of beef things up a little bit. It's a shoulder injury, I'm told, for Ian Marlowe. And that really does sum up the second half. Symptomatic of the handling that we've seen.
Yes, it has. It's been all a little too disappointing. Hull came out all fired up. Try then gave away a penalty just after it, and since then it really has been play between two 25s with neither side being able to dominate it to any great extent.
Harrison. Just switches the play, there's Gay, and then in back, oh dear me, he's put down by Jackson, but Wigan do pick it up this time, it might just give them a chance. Myers trying to get around, mighty, Myers goes, David Myers, and whips it inside. Sean Edwards for the second time in the match, and that must surely now seal the points for Wigan.
Enterprise is part of this game. Myers goes on the outside here, but here again is it is. Look, the backing up from who else but Edwards. Takes the ball on the burst. The defence can do nothing at all about it as he comes over and nonchalantly puts it down, knowing full well that's just about done it.
And Edwards' try guarantees the points now for Wigan. Just when we were thinking they weren't going to get another one, really, because Hull had held out against everything that had been thrown at them. Once again, with 5 minutes to go, we're going to put their seal on it. And the 14-point margin should become 16 with Gotika's fifth goal. That is it, and it's 22-6. And the game is beyond Hull's reach.
Well, the game have lapsed into nothing. Edwards sees the opportunity on the outside to put Myers away. He is the fastest man on the field. He shrugs a couple of tackles. He's just about to get caught. But Edwards has the rugby brain and sense to know that you have to back up. He backs up, and as a result, he scores.
Just a hold up because Wigan are going to take Kelvin Skerritt off to reintroduce Martin Dermott. Good job with the front row for Wigan today. Back to his best. Howie. Really now, Hull won't lose by any more. And, Wigan obviously looking to add to their lead in the last few minutes of the game. But it's Hull who are given the penalty this time.
It's amazing in this game the number of play the balls that haven't been done properly, and that's bad on both sides. Hull in particular, whenever they play the ball, they allow the tackler to come around and take the man and act in the halfback. And it's not only happened once, it's happened a dozen times.
Which is why Mark Jones leads Hull towards Wigan's line. Hull looking for the second try. Now they move it along the line. Mackie switches it. Here's Mark Jones once more. Still looking for his first try as a rugby league player. Well, again a penalty is given, and Hull will have six more tackles from here. They've got to make them count though. Blacker, not sure which way to go, so he comes back inside, and now he goes for the line. Blacker, oh, Brian Blacker, held at 3 yards short. He's didn't seem to know which way to go, and yet again, a penalty given by Wigan. They don't mind doing that, and it's going to be another score for Greg Matthews. Comes after run it.
Well, Mackie has been their inspiration. He's had his ups and downs in this particular game, but it really is his perseverance again that allows him to break this Wigan defence and score his second try. So hard, he's made a lot of passes and his team really haven't been on song. He hasn't had the runners outside him running off him as he would like, but he has made up for it himself, because himself he could be personally gratified that he has scored the two tries.
Well, Eastwood hasn't had many chances obviously either today. Just to maintain a 100% record with this kick. That he does to make it 22. Wigan do have Dean Bell back on, and told he's got some stitches, 10 stitches in that head wound. He's very distinctive now, isn't he? Penalty for Wigan. What will they do with it? Dean Bell is the captain. Comes to tell referee Goltrus that they'll take the kick for goal. They don't need the points as badly as... the boot makes it 6 out of 7, and even more importantly 24 points to 12. Only 3 tries to 2, but Wigan, I think you've got to say good value for their victory, which hasn't yet been confirmed of course. Victory lead for Wigan, 24 points to 12, and again they wrap out the message that this Snellsbitter Championship is not over by a long way yet. Gene Miles goes away with a touch of blood on his face as well by the look of it, but David Watkins, what's your abiding memory?
Well, the early part, the territorial advantage, but Edwards' try from nothing made all the difference. From that early part of the game, it's been an uphill struggle for Hull. It was Edwards again in the second half that really killed off any hopes they ever had.
And there we have it in strict figures, 24 points to 12. Edwards 2 tries, Penapa 1, but Potica's 6 goals weighing heavily on Wigan's side. All had to show 2 tries from Greg Mackey and 2 goals from Paul Eastwood.
As the captain, how pleased were you with the performance today?
I was very pleased for the parts that I can remember anyway. The first 40 minutes I thought was probably our best 40 minutes of the year. They come back at us in the second half, but we're just glad for the win.
You still think there's a bit of work well to do, do you, in the Championship?
Oh yeah, we're not playing to our potential, we've still got a long way to go. I know that we can play probably 50% better than we're playing at the moment.
Why was it that you found the game so hard to put together, really?
I really think it was a case of our own mistakes. They scored off a lot of our drop possession. Can't give Wigan a free ball like that and expect to have a comfortable game, and they certainly made it uncomfortable for us.
From a personal point of view though, 2 tries, not often you get 2 in the same match.
Yeah, 2 league tries goes down well for me, yeah.
It was a quite unrelenting contest at times today, wasn't it? Quite a hard one game.
Yeah, obviously I think that all are now in the fifth division, it's very competitive, and obviously the best team wins, and we're lucky we've got a win today.
It's going to get harder, isn't it, between now and the end of the season?
Oh, especially, I think we've lost just about as many games as we can lose, and we've just got to keep winning.
Here are the details behind the scoreline at Central Park. Hull 6 heeled by the Riversiders. Neither Martin Dermott nor Lee Jackson managed to take one against the head. Tempers were generally well controlled. Wigan conceded 7 penalties, Hull 11, and many were given for non-physical offences like illegal play the balls. And finally, it was a game littered with errors. Wigan, who had more of the ball, spilled 17 passes, Hull just 10. In one of the other games that did survive the weather, St Helens' Kevin Ward is sent off as the leaders go down to Hulkingston Rovers. And Lee Crooks bags 16 points as Castleford overwhelms Swinton. Here's the full picture. Bradford against Warrington, postponed because of frost. They'll try again next Sunday at 3 o'clock. Featherstone against Leeds, victim of the fog. Halifax 29, Salford 12. Hulkingston Rovers 24, St Helens 14. Swinton 4, Castleford 40. Wakefield against Widnes, abandoned after 16 minutes. Again, fog. Wigan 24, Hull 12. St Helens stay top despite losing, with Warrington, Widnes and Leeds all foiled by the weather. Wigan are up 2 places to 3rd, Castleford up 3 to 6th. Swinton and Bradford now find an alarming gap opening up between them and safety. Northern have a game in hand, as do Hulkingston Rovers, who are up 1 place. On to Division 2, and the top 2 clubs met at the Don Valley Stadium. A Lee mistake on a day when cold hands will have proved costly at many grounds let in Sheffield's powerful centre Eva Rapati for the opening try. With a conversion, 6 points for the leaders. But they had a much less happy tale to tell later in the first half. Jason Donoghue fell by this tackle from Sheffield's Tony Tremavave. Considerable anger on both sides about it. The referee, don't forget, must decide if this is an illegal high tackle. Mr. Asquith's verdict, a red card. Donoghue stretched it off, but in fact he did reappear later in the game. By half-time, Lee were 9-6 in front, with 2 goals and a drop from John Woods, and this try from Andy Ruane. With their unbeaten home record under threat, Sheffield hit back. Des Meyer's power taking him over 7 minutes into the second half, 10-9 to Sheffield. But they failed to block John Woods, master of the drop goal, 10-all. The try that decided the match came in the dying seconds. Woods again. May have had more than a decade in the professional game, but he still has the enthusiasm, and his teammate shared his joy at inflicting only Sheffield's 2nd defeat of the season. Sheffield 10, Lee 16. Another man sent off, under 21 international Tommy Martin, after scoring a try in Oldham's win at Rydale York. Just one second division game didn't beat the frost, London Crusaders against Carlisle. Rochdale 42, Workington 8, Rydale York 16, Oldham 22. Sheffield 10, Lee 16. Sheffield's lead cut to 3 points over Lee, and Oldham up a place to 3rd. No obvious salvation in sight for Rydale York. Points difference has passed the 200 mark. In Division 3, Alex Murphy's Huddersfield go to the top for the first time. And Eddie Rombo makes it 4 tries in 3 games as Dewsbury climb to 3rd. The results, Bramley 24, Barrow 6. Dewsbury 38, Chorley 0. Doncaster 50, Whitehaven 14. Highfield 12, Huddersfield 46. And Nottingham against Trafford, Scarborough against Batley, both postponed because of frost. Huddersfield have overtaken Hunslet, who play at Keighley tomorrow, weather permitting. Also moving up, Dewsbury and Doncaster climbing 2 to 7. Yorkshire has staged an international today, featuring the appearance of a team said to be invincible. It happened at Headingley.
Yes, you've guessed it, the Invincibles are Australians, and would you believe it, they're schoolboys. Since their inception in 1972, they're unbeaten in test matches. So Jeff Owen, coach of today's opponents, the Barley Young Lions, knew the enormity of his team's task. On this tour, the Aussies had played 4 matches before today, piling up 128 points and conceding only 13. So it was no surprise when 16-year-old Sydney Domick dashed determinedly for the line. There had been brave talk of an upset before the game, and hope sprang eternal when the Lions hit back with an excellent score of their own from winger Danny Ellison. A hallmark of all Australian sides is their support play at speed, and the next try typified that. The ball fairly fizzing through the hands before wingman Tim Horan broke through 2 tackles to go over. So why are the Australians so superior? The question for British Academy chief Phil Larder.
five or six of the guys that are in the green and gold shirts have already played reserve grade in Sydney, and all our players are obviously amateurs, and it's not a true reflection of Australian rugby league against British rugby league. If you could think of a lot of our players like Steve McCurry and Dean Busby and Dale Powell that and Bobby Golding, I feel, who are age-wise in this category. I think if we were able to play the best of British against the best of Australia, we'd have a far more competitive game.
The Headingley crowd, and especially the Kangaroos supporters, had come expecting to see plenty of tries, and they weren't disappointed. Players like Andrew Ettingshausen, Greg Alexander and Paul Sirenen all started in the green and gold jersey at this level. Michael Buettner and his centre partner Jamie Olajnik could be following in their footsteps. Coach Peter Solis certainly thinks so.
Well, it's hard to predict, but I'd love to think there's two or three there.
And the Lions forward Simon Knox caught the eye of Gary Schofield.
Well, I think the number 12 for Great Britain, he's having a storming game. He's causing problems out wide. He's being raw bones from running second row, which our game's lacking a little bit, especially a little bit at professional level. So if he dedicates himself, who knows, he could be in the full international signing again in about 4 or 5 years' time.
But it was the Kangaroos who came out on top, 44-12, a result to dishearten the British coach.
Devastating. They're a good team, these guys. You compete for 10 minutes, you put them under pressure, and you don't come away with a point. And straight away, they're back downfield, and they make that yardage into points, score tries.
Well, our next scrum down is on January the 12th. And as we head towards a Christmas break, remember those like John Mooney and friends who are 12,000 miles from home.
Just like to wish everybody in Australia a Merry Christmas from the north of England, while all the Australian and New Zealanders are sitting on the beaches. We're in the north of England in the fog, the snow and the frost. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.